Okay, greetings. We're back after that unexpected break. Hope you're tuning in freshly again. Speaking of fresh, we're here with Hunter. And hey, Hunter.
That was a good segue. Yes. How's everything going, man?
Yeah, we're good. We're happy to be here back again, and we'll have a nice discussion with all of our guests here. We've already been chatting a little bit during that unexpected break, and we're going to get into the swap hour coming up in a couple minutes. We're going to show you how to make those swaps, right, Hunter?
Yep. No, for sure.
So we're going to just do quick introductions around the table, let's say, and then get into that. We'll swing it over back to Jay Charming. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. So I'll go ahead and reintroduce myself as well. So again, my name is Hunter. You know, I go by BeFreshHB on YouTube and Library. I just make videos all about crypto. Got involved in this space early 2017. And, you know, pretty much just started making videos and live streaming about a couple months ago. Because I don't know, I love crypto and I, you know, love talking to the people. So it only fits that I'm over here right now with these beautiful people from Verus, Nav, you know, Raven, Komodo, obviously. Learning all about space as much as I can. So happy to be here.
Yeah, happy to be here. Awesome. And we're also joined by a couple of our friends from Komodo here. We got Kadan and we have Jason Brown. Hi, gentlemen.
Hi, hey. Great to be here, guys. And great to have you here. Thank you.
Yeah, excellent. I hope you're enjoying the weekend so far. From your perspective.
Yeah, absolutely. I was wondering, Oink, like, is your cat meditating? Like, how could you keep the cat on that spot for, like, I don't know, you know, we have four cats, like, they keep, like, running through the house and we can't keep them at one spot. I'm really fascinated. I'm impressed.
So am I.
My cat is basically an outside cat, and whenever it gets in, it wants to be with me.
Oh, well, okay. Well, tell us why. Introduce us. This is Oink from Verus community, Verus Coin. Hi, Oink.
Hi. Yes, I'm Oink, and this is Yuki, which is Japanese for snow. Makes kind of sense. Okay, you got me at a loss. You surprised me there. Basically, I'm... always in Discord, primarily via Verus Discord, yet I'm also in other Discords because we have a multi-coin wallet, and I'm always looking if someone runs into something that needs to be relayed to our developers so we can fix it, or if I can lend a hand to solve users' problems.
Nice. Working on that interoperability aspect of things on the ground in interoperations, which is brilliant. That's awesome. Good for you. And we're super happy to have you here. Brilliant. And then we're going to get into that swap hour. I think we're going to throw it to Jay Charming to kick it off for us. And then we're going to come back and talk to Alex from NavCoin and Tron from Ravencoin. How does that sound, Jay Charming?
Absolutely fantastic. Ready to do the kickoff swap and get everything running. So let's see now. We've got the stress test page. It looks like we've got, for a minute and 30 into it to do the kickoff swap, we've got the leaderboard right here, which you can catch updates for the swaps as they come in. That gets updated and refreshed about every 5 minutes. So I'm going to go into my wallet. You can follow along if you've never made a swap before, or you can just join along at this kind of like kickoff swap that we've ended up starting doing. Rick or Morty coin. I think that I was favoring Rick coins at the end of last time, so let's do a Morty. So we've got, you can grab from the faucet right up here. You'll just click if you don't have any, and that will draw you the Morty that you need. Then you can go ahead and click swap, and that gets you to the swap interface. Go ahead and select the Rick pair if you're starting from Morty. If you're starting from Rick, select the Morty pair. And then you're going to go ahead and pick your order. You're going to set your order size. I'm just going to do a one for one about. One Rick for just a little around one Morty. I'm going to go ahead, or one Morty for one Rick. And I'm going to go ahead and make sure that it's on sell. I'm going to start swap. I'm going to do a kickoff swap here. And there it goes. The order is queued. It is going to be picked up. You can even watch in real time how this atomic swap takes off and follow along with that process. If you like that intro, that extra technicality, you can come to our Discord and you can ask questions. We've got a support channel there. You can tweet at us, and you can go to our Reddit and you can lurk around our sub. We've got information and people all over the place. The Komodo community is a wonderful helping community. So, and then you can just go ahead and keep on making more swaps. Go back to your trade tab and pick up more if you want to, and just keep on swapping, build that volume. I think yesterday every single event was getting to around 10,000 plus, and we even had one event that by the time that the entire event was over, not just the swap hour but the entire event, they had reached 20,000. So with that in mind, I'd love to see any of the events today break the 10,000 mark for sure, break the 20,000 mark. I think we broke 100,000 swaps in total this weekend so far, which was basically our stretch goal. So now, you know, we're like, hey, can we make a million by the end of the year? We're just super curious. So I'm going to hand it back over. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jay Charming. Yes, happy swapping, everyone. I got one going. I remember for some time, Morty was more favored. You had a better price against Rick, but now it seems like Rick is Rick and no, sorry, other way around. Rick is the crazy dude. Rick, I love it. I love these coins. You know, it reminds me of the beer and the pizza tests. Those are fun too. But this is great. And now I think Morty has some good favor between the traders. It's almost pretty equal. So that's great. I wonder what everyone else is trading. I wonder. Alex is here from Nav. NavCoin. Alex, you want to introduce yourself, NavCoin, and maybe tell us what you're trading? You like Rick? You like Morty? What are you trying to do? Or are you just swapping them all over the place? Oh, we can't hear you, yeah. Alex.
I don't think we can hear anything.
Okay, we're going to jump quickly over to Tron from Ravencoin, okay? And then we'll come back to you, Alex. Hey, Tron, what's up? Why don't you introduce and quickly, you were telling us a little bit during that break, you were telling us something pretty cool about Ravencoin. Do you want to just quickly go through that again?
Sure, absolutely. So my name is Tron Black. I'm the lead developer for Ravencoin. Ravencoin is a coin that it was spun out of Bitcoin. It was a code fork, not a chain fork, code fork of Bitcoin. And it allows you to create any tokens you want. So you can go in and you have to pick a unique name. So it has kind of a registration system that, you know, works across the blockchain, figures out to make sure that you only get one, one unique name. So you choose the name, you choose the quantity, you choose how divisible, you choose whether it's reissuable or not, meaning you can make more later. And then you can put all your metadata in IPFS. So that basically tells people kind of permanently what your coin or token is about. You can create anywhere from 1 to 21 billion of them, and it costs 500 Raven, which is, you know, like $5-6. $8, a little bit. Then you have those tokens, and they, you know, they just work, you know, like tokens. They move, you know, between all the wallets. We have lots of wallets, for Ravencoin, and about 4 or 5 wallets to work with tokens. And so you can move in between that. So that's Ravencoin. It's pretty decentralized. It was kind of spun out of Medici Ventures. Lots of nodes. I've been in the space since 2013. I'm the dev, and we're kind of shifting to foundation based, kind of beginning of next year.
Wonderful. And right. Hunter, who else we have here?
Yeah, and it looks like we also have Alex from NavCoin. Alex, you here with us? I think he's having an issue with
troubles
his mic.
With Alex. Okay.
Yes.
All right. Well, you know what? Let's get into this. Alex, once you come back around, there's definitely some time to spotlight NavCoin. So when you get going here, we'll hear more from you. I'm wondering here, we're talking about interoperability. Oink, you were talking about interacting with a lot of different discords and communities. Do you want to kick it off with what interoperability means to you, and maybe you want to tie it back into Komodo Atomic Dex, or just really keep it around Verus as well, because Verus has a lot to talk about for sure.
Yeah, Verus indeed has a lot to talk about. Thanks for that. Let me kick off with what's on mainnet already before I start showing off or telling you about what's on testnet and what's coming. On mainnet, we currently have Verus IDs, and that those are self-sovereign digital IDs, which are attestable. In other words, if you have some kind of organization that wants to attest some data, for example, your passport data, your ID data, your KYC data, they can attest to that onto your ID. And the owner of the ID has full control over that as to whether to disclose that information or part of that information to third parties. So that means that the user is in full control. Apart from that, the digital IDs, the Verus IDs, are revocable and recoverable. So in case you lose your keys or your keys get compromised, you have the possibility to revoke your ID, and all your funds in it and all the attestations in it, etc., they're all safe, and you can recover them to a different key set.
That's really big. That's really big, yeah. By the way.
And these revocation and recovery options can be configured to be multi-sig. So what you can even do is, and I have that right now on my ID, you can give out keys to your children, your lawyer, etc., that in case that I decease, they can revoke my ID and recover it to a new address, so they can access my funds after I pass away or I'm otherwise not available. And because of the multi-sig feature, you can specify that you only need one signature, or you need all signatures, or only part of the signatures. So wow. That is very powerful right now. The Verus IDs includes something called the Verus Exchange Data Format, where you can put in data. The attestations go in there, but you could also use it for domain referral. So it can act as a domain system. For example, I have an ID Oink. I can in future create a PBAS chain called Oink and have sub IDs or can create IDs on that. For example, www.oink or whatever.oink, and that goes on and on. And the good part is a Verus ID can not only be used for that, but you can also use it to transfer funds to it, holds your funds. And you don't need to use the name R and then blah, 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 all those characters behind it. But I can actually send funds to Oink, or if I have a private ID attached to it, I can send funds to Oink at, which is the ID, and then colon private. And the daemon basically figures out what private address is attached to my ID and sends it to that private address on my ID. So I don't need to look up any numbers anymore.
Cool. Very cool.
Really convenient. And that is what is on mainnet right now. With the next big release, we're going to add the Verus Vault, which allows you to time lock your ID. And that means in order to do any spends on it, apart from staking will still be able, will still be enabled. But in order to do any transactions from your ID, you'll need to either wait a set amount of blocks that you put in there, or you can have it unlock at a certain block in the future. So what I can do is I can make a savings account as an ID and just send funds every now and then, which will unlock X years into the future. And that can be useful, for example, setting up a college fund for your kids, that kind of stuff.
Very cool. And I just wanted to mention that Alex has, so thank you, Oink. And I want to just mention that Alex has returned. And I know Hunter has a question to ask too, so I'm going to definitely throw it over to you just a second, though, just to say hi back to Alex. And just to mention about NavCoin also having some address ID, Navi address, and also some privacy features that are going to get talked about. Alex, you're going to get a chance to talk about that momentarily as well, okay? So thanks for getting back to us.
Yeah, sure. I think that you didn't get my introduction before. So first of all, let me introduce me. I'm Alex from the NavCoin team. I've been working for Nav since 2016, so it's been already a while. And basically, we are payments coins with a focus on quick and fast payments, but also with a focus on privacy. That we can talk about this later, about the details of the new protocol that we are about to release. And yeah, we also implemented Open Alias, that is a protocol created by Monero, by the Monero community, which allows to translate email addresses into normal NavCoin addresses. So for an user, it's really easy to send coins to someone without having to remember this long address that sometimes looks a bit cryptic.
Nice. Thank you for that quick intro. And we'll get back more into Nav, and you can just differentiate a little bit. We'll go back and forth a bit between Verus and Nav and find out how things are similar and how things are different. How does that sound?
Yeah, sure.
Perfect. All right. So yeah, as I mentioned, again, beautiful stuff all around in terms of the Open Alias and, you know, Verus ID that you guys had mentioned. What I really wanted to ask is, and I'm a big advocate for it, is of ease of use, again, for the average consumer, right, the average person. And my question, I guess, mainly in this case for, you know, Tron over at Ravencoin, what role would you say ease of use plays in interoperability? You know, I know that, again, Verus is Verus ID, NavCoin is Open Alias, but I'm just, you know, interested to hear your thoughts on, you know, how important it is pretty much to make sure this stuff is easy to use, especially with how complicated interoperability can be.
Yeah, no, that is tricky. Ease of use is everything. A lot of these things, I mean, I'm kind of just stuttering here.
I always stutter. It's okay.
It's necessary for ease of use for the entire, for every coin, for ecosystem. And this stuff's complex enough, holding your own keys, having to store right down 12 words, being your own bank, all of that's complex enough. And so the ability to just be able to move between ecosystems. And it's really I think of it as kind of the network of value. So the ability to just shift value around between the ecosystems seamlessly is absolutely critical.
And then it's another little, go for it, Alex.
I think something that is important to say about, you know, our new protocol, XNav, it is the new privacy protocol that we are going to release, is that it's compatible with atomic swaps. This is a first for a private coin. For example, you have Zcash right now that you can make atomic swaps with the transparent Zcash, but you are not able to make atomic swaps directly with the shielded Zcash. Monero, for example, now is starting to work in an implementation of a protocol to be able to do atomic swaps, but our new protocol, XNav, is going to allow to do the atomic swaps directly with the private coin. That this is great for the privacy of the user and also in terms of cost, to make the cost and fees way lower. And I think privacy is something really important for the user, especially in the times that we are right now with the COVID crisis. I think we are all starting to be way more aware of the importance of privacy. We've seen some tries to kind of start to outlaw cash. I've seen here in Berlin many supermarkets that they have like signs on the entrance, please don't pay with cash, trying to communicate or trying to introduce the message that cash can be a vector for infection for COVID, and trying to push people into use digital payments more and more, which is super convenient because you can pay really fast. You don't have to worry about bringing enough cash with you, but brings a lot of problems in terms of privacy when you are using a public blockchain, because everyone can see everything that is happening. So I think this new protocol XNAV is really important in the context that we are living right now, because it brings privacy back to the protocol and it allows interoperability with other chains thanks to the support with atomic swaps.
Wow, thank you. Thank you, Alex. That's cool to know about the atomic swaps and the privacy. And also this what you're saying, this sounds like echoes from the previous conversation of event 4 that we had around privacy. So you can check that one out too, if you want. Yeah. And also, you know, that also reminded me of the subatomic swaps that are something that have been talked about a little bit. But here today, we're really focused on the atomic DEX, and we're within the fifth swap hour event. So we're going to have some stats pretty soon. But I just wanted to also push it over to Oink and ask, because you had briefly mentioned about dealing with different communities. Verus has a pretty extensive wallet, I think it is. And I think also there are different levels or layers of interoperability. Would you like to talk a little bit about that? And then I think there's a lot of excitement around the PBAS and its possibilities with some interoperability. Did you want to mention anything about that and highlight things?
Yes, indeed. Basically, what we have right now on testnets is token creation, AMM or automatic market makers pools. So you can make coin pools. And we are working hard on a bridge with the Ethereum ecosystem. And that would mean that people can send in any ERC20 token or ETH token into the Verus ecosystem and back, convert them. And the conversion process is actually a very nice thing to go through. Through an automated market maker at very low fees. It is very complicated to explain, but what you can do is simply say, okay, from your wallet, I want to send from CoinEx to token Y, and there's a pool in between, and it just goes through in one thing. And the big difference with automatic market makers on the Ethereum ecosystem is that they're not run sequentially, so there's no front running, but they are working in parallel. Everything gets aggregated into a block, and every transaction in the block gets the same conversion price. So there's not someone jumping in front of you getting the big advantage. It makes it fair for everyone who wants to transfer and convert that coins into something else. And that ties in with Atomic DEX, because Atomic DEX is a completely decentralized protocol. This is also a completely decentralized protocol. It is not a layer 2 protocol on top of the blockchain, where the blockchain is not aware that that financial service is running. It is a protocol built into the blockchain onto blockchain level. So you also won't have the risk that someone makes a solidity contract and it turns out to have some vulnerabilities in there and people lose money. Everybody uses the same protocol on blockchain level.
Wow. This seems like a very big undertaking, and it's still in development. But that's very exciting overall. I imagine I can hear the excitement in your voice too. So we're going to have some stats pretty soon. I'm just going to cue in Jay Charming. Do you have any stats for us quickly? Apart from that, actually, Karan, you know that somebody solved the crypto puzzle that you put forward?
Yeah, I noticed yesterday. I had a look on the key. I actually had the wallet open and I just took like a quick nap. I woke up and saw it was like on zero. I haven't figured yet for who it was. So we're going to ask just like in the community later today, like for the solver to just like make a quick post and to out himself or herself. But it has been cracked and I mean, I can release the word. I'm not sure. Has it been already announced and said like what the solution was, the seed to the crypto puzzle?
That's actually what we're doing right now, I think. Oink, okay, you know awesome. What it is, Oink? Are you
taking I know. There you go. A guy in Vera's Discord figured it out 4 minutes after someone else got the solution.
I saw that.
I can check in Vera's Discord what the exact solution is, but I'll leave that up to you.
Yeah, no, I saw that too. And that's I'm glad you mentioned that. It's true. And it made it more fun for me, for sure. And Kadan is pointing at it right now. There it is.
The red saber light, absolutely.
Thank you. Well, I hope you had fun with that puzzle, Kadan. It made it fun for me to see that somebody got there 4 minutes late. I'm really sorry for you for having gotten there 4 minutes late, but it just shows that there's enthusiasm for this. Obviously, you know, it's got a monetary value, whatever, but it's fun, you know, and people are trying things. And so I'm glad that you offered that puzzle.
We'll definitely add up these sort of puzzles. I mean, I've discussed also with Aldo yesterday. I mean, we've seen this stress test event that we're now holding for the second day. This turned into something like a blockchain event, like literally, you know, like we're discussing a lot of different topics. We went into layers such as socioeconomic discussions, etc. It's like quite interesting. It wasn't just like focused around the atomic DEX or in particularly around the stress test. And I think this is what made it like even more exciting for us, for the Komodo team, that I hope that at least it does show like the openness, you know, like that we are actually a very open team and open community. And I also believe in times like the ones we are living now, it's like quite tough time, right? This anti-social distancing and all these things. So this is like quite like important to keep the line up to the community, to other participants. And I believe it was like a really great way like to hold this. And yeah, I thank you all guys for participating and for being part of this. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks for having us and for doing this and for all the work that you guys do. Shout out again to the whole Komodo team. You guys work so hard to make this happen on different angles, different levels. And shout out to our guests joining us today, right, Hunter? You know, Verus, Nav, and Ravencoin specifically here. We really appreciate all the hard work you're doing and trying to work within the space and push things forward into new and amazing ways that we can't even think of yet. And just the most brilliant minds are really starting to crack open. So thank you for that. Oink, we're going to go for a break in like a few minutes here. Is there any last specific thing you want to say about Verus? And then Alex, it would be great after the break, if you can talk about NavCoin and maybe relate to some of the things Oink might've been saying that touches back to you. Oink, you talked about the address, the Verus ID. Did you want to talk at all more specifically about privacy or anything else like that? Or what are your last words for this moment?
Verus is optionally private with respect to funds transferring. But the real privacy options are locked into the concept of a Verus ID, where the holder of the ID basically decides whether to disclose any information to third parties or not.
That sounds that like is, what Lutz was saying yesterday. That's interesting. Lutz was talking about a desire to be voluntary about privacy, like you privacy by default, but the option to show is there. Anyway, that's interesting you mentioned that. Thank you. Keep going, sorry.
Yeah, privacy by default is still privacy by choice, because no offense to any privacy coins, but if you decide to choose a 100% privacy coin, you opt in to use privacy. And privacy coins may make it easy to maintain your privacy because you don't have to think about it. But a change like Zcash or Komodo or any ZK SNARK enabled chain, actually, you can maintain nearly the same level of privacy. You just have to take the proper steps. And a 100% privacy coin takes away those steps from the people, so they don't have to think about it. It makes it easier to use privacy. But it is still possible on ZK-enabled, ZK-SNARK-enabled coins or any other privacy coin, actually.
Cool. Hey, tell me, so for the wallet, for the Verus wallet, you need, when you're using privacy coins, you have a multi-coin wallet there. Do you and you can run it on the light mode, or you can, for example, Pirate Chain or any ZK SNARKs enabled, it would have to be a native mode. Did you want to just make a quick plug for the wallet? And is NavCoin on the wallet? Is Ravencoin on the wallet? Is that sort of thing possible? What did you want to say about the wallet? And then we're going to go to break.
Okay, we are working right now on a new implementation where, at least for Verus, it will enable you to use light mode for Zcash transaction, Zmode transactions, and Verus IDs, not just for the desktop wallet, but also for the mobile wallets, so any light wallet, basically. And once that is implemented and a chain is capable of running a light mode service in their wallets, it should be possible to implement in Verus as well, as long as it's reasonably compatible. For all the coins that are in the wallet, I don't actually remember which ones are available, but I remember to have seen Raven in our light mode wallet. So possibly not. I don't know. I can't say anything definite about that.
No worries. Well, if Ravencoin and NavCoin want to chat with you, they can do that behind the scenes. Is that right?
It's good to do it.
Perfect. Oh, lovely. We love this. Anyway, we are going to hit the break. And then after that, we're going to hear from Alex. And Alex, maybe you can differentiate Nav a little bit. Thank you, Oink, for sharing all that cool information about Verus. And you're still around, so we're still going to hear from you after the break. We're going to take a 10-minute break. After the break, we'll hit up the stats to begin with, hopefully. And then we'll continue swapping anyway through the break, hopefully. And yeah, enjoy yourselves. We'll see you in 10 minutes. And there was a lot of privacy talk there. So if you're interested to hear more, we have a recording on the YouTube channel, a little behind the scenes, after hours type of talk about privacy and all that stuff. So thanks for joining. Hunter, we'll see you around on the other side of the break.
You got it. See you on the other side.
Thank you.
Welcome back for the live stream during event 5's stress test hour right now. We're going to get some stats very soon. So hope you're having fun. And yeah, we've got a great rest of this segment. We're going to talk about NavCoin specifically, and we're going to hear some more from Verus. And we've got Polycrypto blog, Jason Brown from Komodo, who's going to share about interoperability as well. You know, first though, I really would like to know what's happening with these swap stats. Jay Charming is coming around now because I just keep pulling on his shirt here saying, come on, I really need to know. You know, all these previous events have been very successful. I think expectations have been smashed by at least one order of magnitude. So that's pretty cool. Pretty cool. So Jay Charming, you there with some stats for us?
Yeah, absolutely. So I've got the stats up for this atomic swap hour on my screen right now. 4,966 swaps total. 216 users participating. Absolutely fantastic.
Nice.
This is I would say this is definitely on par with our other events. You know, I went in and did a little bit of peeking around with Tony, which, by the way, big shout out to Tony, who was fixing things yesterday. This stat site just had a little bit of an update or a graphical error that it was showing. And I messaged Tony, and basically, like, within 2 minutes, he's like, yeah, it's all good. So again, like, another kind of like save the day moment with something was going on. Big props and shout out to Tony there, because there's so many people behind the scenes that are running everything and making everything work. And Komodo is 90% devs. It's just, everybody here is so great, led underneath CA here. Nice. So
good stats.
Yeah.
It sounds like you're appreciating what's going on right now. Sounds like it's on par.
Yeah, we were peeking into the stats. Sure. Yeah, we were peeking to the stats yesterday, and that huge you were plugging about that huge, like, kind of pop time. There was one that excelled, and that was the Einsteinium and Qtum communities. That they went back to back, and Tony and I went around and poked around at some of the stats and things like that. And it looked like basically all the EMC2 users, the Einsteinium users, rolled right over into the Qtum hour, and they actually had about fairly equal registration. So it didn't matter. Like, you could be a small community, you could be a massive community. Both of them can galvanize pretty much and get, like, they landed 20,000 swaps working together. And that was, like, really, really cool to get to see. So, and I also want to give a little moment of, like, if you talking about crypto puzzles earlier, if you go hashtag crypto puzzle, you do not have to scroll far, and you can see the crypto puzzles that our own CA333 was releasing. We're out there. This is definitely something I heard that's going to be coming back again, getting to make a lot of primetime spotlights. So wanted to be sure to give a little shout out there.
All right. Congratulations so far to everyone, and stay tuned for more prizes and great opportunities like that. Okay. So back with Hunter. How's it going, Hunter? You enjoying yourself? And who do you want to talk to right now? What do you want to say?
I'm having a ball. Okay. I'm just listening to all this beautiful knowledge here in the morning. Again, 7:44 over here in New York. So, you know, it's never too early to learn about, you know, about privacy, interoperability, and, you know, more ZK snarks.
Oh yeah, and ID stuff too, isn't it? What do you think?
Oh yeah, no. Especially with the whole, open alias, obviously Verus ID. I'm always a big fan of ease of use. I guess especially kind of coming from more like a marketing type of background. You know, if the masses aren't using it, then what's the point of making it? So it's amazing to see that, you know, all these projects are really kind of starting to realize that not only is our, you know, technology important, but so is the people who are going to be using it. They need to know how to use it, you know? So it makes sense.
So then let's flip over quickly to Alex over here then. Talk to us about this open alias.
Yeah, I agree with Hunter completely that ease of use and user experience is really important to achieve adoption. That is something that I think we are all targeting. And open alias is a protocol created by Monero that what it allows is to create in your own domain DNS entries that are linked to an NavCoin address. Well, you can use addresses from many blockchains, but in our case, you can use a NavCoin address, which is a public address, or you can also link your open alias to an XNAP address. So it allows you to use it privately. And it's quite easy to use. You just have to register this DNS entry in your domain to link it to the NavCoin address. And because this, for some users, can be a bit complicated because they need to have their own domain name, we also allow users to register open alias addresses in our own domain, in the nav.community domain. So you can have, for example, alex at nav.community, link it to your address, and receive coins in that way, which I think is super convenient for the users.
Nice. Okay. What do you think, Hunter? Do you have a follow-up for that?
Oh, yeah. No, definitely. I mean, again, as you mentioned, especially, it's really cool. I didn't realize that you used, what's it called? That was Monero. That actually I had made that before. It's interesting seeing how all these privacy coins introducing something like open alias or a way to identify people on the blockchain. You'd almost think it's a little bit counterintuitive, but again, it kind of goes back to that letting the everyday person keep their privacy, but at the same time be able to use it easily, because, you know, again, using a string of letters or numbers and whatnot to identify, let's say, your brother, if you want to send him some Bitcoin or whatnot, it doesn't make any sense in the real world, that is.
Almost like it makes sense. So it's almost like a way to keep privacy while at the same time trusting the truth of the identification. Is that, Oink, you want to take a shot at that? And then we're going to come back to Alex and see what more he has to say.
Yeah, I think being able to trust that someone is who he is one of the most important things in life. If I see what you can do in governments, etc., but also proving that something has been published by you, whether it be a binary, a piece of text, a picture, or anything. And it's something I didn't mention before. Verus ID allows you to sign binaries and messages. And you can verify that on a blockchain that's recently updated. It doesn't need to be online, and you can simply check if the binary comes from that ID, is signed by that ID. Basically, all our wallets are signed by the Veruscoin Foundation. Simply to protect our users from fake wallets.
Oh, yes. I've noticed that recently. And speaking of which, I think it's a good opportunity to plug safety. Don't be confused by DMs, direct messages, and other. There's a lot of fakeness and a lot of scams going around. And especially during events like this, you notice it pops up even more. So just be careful out there. And thanks to Verus for implementing that. That really helps. And, just hearing from everybody about the different technologies that are being worked with and experimented with and tried, this is huge and it's so important. And I'm super, super thankful for all of you for all the hard work and effort and dedication you put into it. So, Alex, did you want to continue talking about the open alias? Is there anything else you wanted to say? You said that it's been going on for some time now. Did you want to instead move on to what is coming in 2021 and what type of features you're working with there?
There's something that I forgot about Open Alias that is a new use for Open Alias that we are going to introduce on the 1st of January. That XNAV, the new privacy protocol, is going to allow also to send small encrypted messages in the transactions. So actually, you will be able to use Open Alias as kind of a private messaging protocol, because you are going to be able to send encrypted messages to an email address. So it can be seen as a kind of limited, because the length of the message is not unlimited, but it can be seen as a private privacy message protocol.
Like an alternative to Proton Mail, perchance?
No, it's not like Proton Mail, because as I said, the length of the message is limited, but it can be used as a kind of private chat platform.
Right.
Nice.
For short messages.
That's cool. And I think that that's becoming a little more popular too. And if you want to, anyone else wants to say something about that, that'd be nice. But, Alex, what is coming up for 2021 for you and for NavCoin? I want to make sure that you spotlight what you're working on and get out exactly what you want to say.
Yeah, I'm super excited about 2021 because on the 1st of January, we are putting out XNav, which is our new privacy protocol that is based on BLSCT. That is a protocol that we created from scratch. It is a combination of BLS signatures and confidential transactions. BLS signatures, what it allows is to combine many signatures into a single one, which is great for scalability. It reduces a lot the space that the transactions take on the blockchain. And using the combination of BLS signatures and confidential transactions, we build, I will say, a second layer application that we call XNav. XNav is going to be a new token on the NAV blockchain that is going to have privacy features. Users are going to be able to swap one-to-one from NAV to XNav completely freely. And once we have XNav out on the 1st of January, we will move our focus, especially on integrations on decentralized exchanges. We would love to see XNav integration in Atomic Dex, but we also want to build an ERC20 bridge. So we hope to bring NAV to Uniswap. We want to give more importance to decentralized exchanges in the market share of NavCoin. It's one of our goals for 2021. And we also want to move, because initially we are going to have both tokens on the chain, XNav and NAV, but our goal is to move into a full privacy coin, because I think that is really important that there are as less traces on the blockchain as we can. So the chances for someone that is observing the chain to guess the transaction flow of a user are reduced. Because if you have two tokens, one public token and one private token, there are some artifacts left on the blockchain that can let someone to guess or to have more probability of knowing which coins that you are moving into out in or out of the private token, to who belong and where do they come before.
Yeah, it's interesting you're mentioning this, because we heard ideas like that again when we were talking about the privacy. Thank you for sharing that, and it's obviously important to you, isn't it? You mentioned that you actually came from Monero. NavCoin is an offshoot of Monero in some form. And CA 333, Kadan, was mentioning earlier about Monero and atomic swaps. We were just during the break. Kadan, are you there? And did you want to say something about Monero and atomic swaps? I know it's a bit early, but you had mentioned something pretty interesting and curious. And I'm sure that other people would benefit from hearing from you.
Yes, sure. I mean, we've been like playing, experimenting with this kind of things and just like doing also deeper research, right? I mean, there are sort of proof of concept code bases already around, specifically targeting our code based technology stack. And I mean, I can say that this is something that is certainly coming, at one specific point of time, there will be like full support to crypto node atomic swaps. And that will also include Monero, right? That's a privacy token that then could be exchanged through a cross-chain atomic swap on the atomic DEX as well. A few things are uncertain as of now. For example, how will such an implementation look like, right? I mean, we know there are regulatory limitations, legal limitations, etc. Sometimes even for an end user in specific jurisdictions, it can become quite complex just to run this sort of software. So probably likely we're going to see like some sort of plugin, right, that you could sort of attach, detach, or kind of enable, disable, that would then provide the functionality for a crypto node swap, right? This is like sort of just a rough vision on this, on how this could look. But yes, just to answer the question in general, just like to give the users an idea on what's coming, this is certainly coming. And we're working on far more integrations and implementations, right? So we try to cover the entire second, third generation blockchain protocol compatibility. Means we really want to get like Atomic DEX, the Atomic DeFi core, to just absolute wide industry support, right? So that any project can just go ahead and use it.
Oh, wow, thank you. Yeah, and I guess that says something about the difficulties of interoperability, and some problems are bigger than others, but there are a lot of challenges for you. Did you want to just briefly say anything more about that, or does what you said pretty much cover it?
Yes, I'm referring and concerning the challenges. There are a lot of challenges, but we also need to keep in mind there are a lot of problems to solve, right, in this industry. So, I mean, we are here. We are ready to take all these challenges. One thing I wish that will sort of increase and kind of get boosted in the coming months and years is further engagement from third-party communities, from other communities, right? We need to use the power of the network. We need to connect with each other. Sometimes you are doing research, sometimes you're reading code, you're trying to figure something. But in fact, I'm certain someone else already did this on this planet. And it's probably gonna be someone who is actually in a cryptocurrency community, right? We just haven't met, we haven't spoken yet. I believe a lot of resources are being wasted and go to a waste because of these separations, right? We have separations, not just in the real world outside there, but even in the crypto communities. If we follow all these communities, yes, you see certain community members connect to a lot of different communities and projects, but the projects themselves often are sort of isolated and operate in a closed environment. And I believe once this really enhances and improves, and we will see projects really collaborating on a core, for example, we're targeting to provide full support for all third and second generation blockchain protocols out there. It would be genius if, for example, one of these protocols would just like get in touch with us and say, hey guys, we checked your DEX and we've like the library ready for full support for our protocol. You can just like basically integrate it and that's it, right? We have like explanation on the GitHub and so on. And these sort of collaborations, right? So basically having the third parties actually do their integrations and this sort of improvement, you know, it will just like boost the entire space when we start basically doing just like what we're really the best in, but not doing it just for us, but also doing it for others. And the others do what they are best in also for us. Like, you know what I mean?
Yes.
Not my native language, but I'm trying just like to express these emotions and thoughts, which I believe are blocking us, the entire world and humanity as such.
Please, thank you. Yes, and I'm just gonna follow two up here. One is when you're so. Firstly, yes, and that sounds so much like what Komodo is about. We're going to break literally in like a minute here. So, Karan, you're gonna be quick, like maybe a one or two word answer here. But yes, Komodo really is about sharing and collaborating and interoperating. And so I'm so glad you mentioned what you did and how you said it. Now, if you're dreaming. Okay, you're dreaming, you're sleeping so well after this stress test and you're sleeping well and you're having a great dream. It's not a nightmare, it's a good dream. Who is that? Who are those projects? If you can, give us one or two coins that it would really make your dream a happy dream. If in your dream they said, hey, we've got everything ready and we want to, you know, do that. What would that be for you?
You know, I really wouldn't like pick just like a specific project, but because I believe that it's really the variety is so big, and sometimes a top 500 token, which is really down in the list, will probably have a really genius dev or someone, you know, on the technical side. I mean, you know, every single project that we've talked with and that we've had here on board during this event, every single project of these projects. These are a few just like to start with, right? I believe the collaboration is still suboptimal, right? There is a collaboration. It's not enough, right? There's a lack of transparency, a lack of communication. It's not just like, it's all our faults, right? This is like a team effort. We all like messed this up, right? Over the last decades and the way intercommunication between different projects takes place. So just like to answer the question, it wouldn't be just like one or two projects. In my optimal dream, it would be all of us, right? It would be really all projects, we would figure an optimal communication channel where you would have, like, you know, an AI, for example, could like create clusters of specific topics based on specific keywords, discussion topics, areas of skills, etc. So you wouldn't have this flood of information. You wouldn't have like to filter so much. And I believe it is technically possible. So in my dream, we would be just like all interconnected. And I mean, we humans, we are all connected, right? I believe in this spiritual connection. I believe if we get this done on the technical layer, we've won. You know what
Pangea.
I mean? Like, humanity is saved if this happens.
Right on, Kadan. Here, here.
Hope this makes sense. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, thank you too. And thank you everyone who's joined us so far. We're going to take that break right now. Thank you, Oink and Alex and Ravencoin. And we're going to get to Ravencoin and Jason Brown from Komodo, Tron from Ravencoin. Hunter is going to lead us through a nice discussion there. And so thank you to Hunter for being here. And I mean, Giuliano, we're going to sign off for this break right now. The stress test hour is over, but keep on swapping. We'll get those stats up. Yeah, once again, thank you, Kadan, for sharing those wise thoughts. And I hope I meet you in your dreams too, because that sounds like a great dream. All right.
Thank you.
We'll take that break.
I appreciate the question. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay, back for this last segment here for event five. We're doing this swap thing with Komodo Platform's Atomic DEX. So glad you could join us. And Hunter's going to take it away now. We are joined also by Charles. Yeah, we're joined by Charles from the biz dev team there from Komodo, along with Polycrypto Blog. And just to reintroduce again, we have Tron from Ravencoin. Hunter, how's it going? You enjoying yourself? And take us away here.
Of course. Yeah, no, I mean, I'm definitely excited to talk a little more about Ravencoin and Komodo and see kind of maybe how the two kind of operate together. But my first question really here is, and Tron, you can actually take this one first and maybe we can see it with the biz development team from Komodo thinks. So what do you guys think the most important form of a unique token or NFT is going to be like 2021, in this coming year? I mean, NFTs have blown up the past year, so I'm definitely interested in your thoughts.
Yeah, so we kind of support all different kinds and kind of let the market decide which ones are most important. But one thing that I think is interesting is the actual security token. And so we've built into the platform the ability to do not just create a token, but to create a token that operates, we call it restricted asset, and it's a subset of a token that can move freely amongst all addresses, which is, you know, we have those, and those just, you know, have a name. If the token on Ravencoin starts with a dollar sign, it's a restricted asset, which means that it has a few different rules, and it allows the issuer more control than you'd expect in a kind of a crypto environment. You know, normally it's like you create it, you have it, you have the keys, you own it. In this case, if it has a dollar sign, it means the issuer can freeze it in place, can prevent trading of it, and can also do can tag it with a tag like a KYC tag or an accredited tag. And these are kind of call them non-crypto spirit type things, but it is a tool set that allows security tokens to work, right? So to create, let's say, a token that it can only move if it's, you know, if the person's been KYC'd, et cetera. And so we have that tool set kind of built in. And so I think that may get used quite a bit over the next year. And I don't recommend it for everything. I mean, if you don't need it, you know, use the regular tokens. You use privacy tokens. You know, I don't want, you know, Ravencoin to get pigeonholed into a, you know, oh, that's the one that's, you know, all regulated
KYC coin.
It's a tool set. And so that tool set exists, but it's totally optional and also easily identified, right? So if it has a dollar sign in front of it, the issuer has extra controls. But there's a whole bunch of things within Ravencoin that kind of help those types of issuers. Because if you do restrict it, for example, there are a lot of laws, securities laws on the books, Rule 144 stock, right? Can't move, because it's owned, for example, by the principals of the company or things like that. And you can actually use IPFS to kind of mark it as, hey, this is frozen under Rule 144 because, you know, they own a, you know, crap ton of this token because they were the issuers and they're not, you know, kind of allowed to trade it. And so you can put that metadata on chain, or at least linked on chain immutably to the IPFS, to kind of show that these shares can't move, these shares can. You can freeze shares by address or globally. But again, this is just one type of token, right, that starts with a dollar sign, and no other Ravencoin tokens start with a dollar sign. Right? They have to have a unique name. And so it's kind of a specific thing. I don't want to Ravencoin to get pigeonholed in that, but I do want to kind of point out that is a tool set that's fairly unique in the industry that some issuers may like.
Yeah, no, and you know what? That's a great point, especially, even in terms of talking about getting pigeonholed, it's still a great, you know, thing to have as an option, right? I mean, especially for companies in 2020, 2021, I mean, we've recently saw a huge shift in a lot of companies just starting to buy Bitcoin and buying different cryptos. I'm sure it's not too far of a stretch to think that they're going to start using some of these, assets, especially ones that are restricted where they can have control of it. I mean, obviously, right?
Yeah.
So, and with that being said, obviously, Polycrypto, Caden, if you guys want to jump in as well, I mean, what do you guys think are going to be the most important form of an NFT coming up?
Sure. I think NFTs, they hold a lot of potential because it really is the uniqueness factor. I mean, that's, the whole purpose of them. But we have to think of, like, how many things are really require that uniqueness. And one that, struck me, gave me a eureka moment was the concept of utilizing NFTs for copyright to basically have a, I don't want to say a physical, but it's like a data representation of this inherent right. And in the U.S., copyright doesn't need to be registered with, like, the government and such. So it's basically given, immediately as upon the creation of the work. I see this type of utilization of NFTs as creating like a whole like information marketplace. And we have a project in the Komodo ecosystem called Surely that might work pretty well with this as well. It could allow the transfer, the trades between private currencies and these digital rights. I agree with Tron as well. Security tokens are probably going to take the forefront, but I think on if you're looking at the bleeding edge, it's really the tokenization of intangible type of things.
For Juliana.
Nah, man. Yeah, it's so true. Polycrypto blog Jason really understands the principles, and I really enjoy hearing you talk about it. You've really opened my eyes to a lot of the potential. So thank you, and continue, please.
Yeah, no, I mean, again, great stuff. Especially, it's all stuff that I can personally see a lot of different companies potentially using, especially copyright. Obviously, it's a huge thing with content media like YouTube. I know Twitch just integrated something with their copyright system where they're kind of they have to go back now. They have to retrospect and see which content creators have been using certain music that was copyrighted. So, imagine they had crypto from the beginning, they wouldn't need to do that most likely, right? So I can definitely see that playing a big role in the future.
Right. But it's a mechanism of proving ownership too. Because one of the big issues in copyright is say you put out a blog article, but some bigger source takes it and they're able to rank it quicker and stuff, and you don't have some, timestamp wasn't set right on your thing or whatever. So you can't prove that you actually did it first. Or same thing with the photo. Did you take the photo first? Because it's the first person who did the image. With the token, you're able to prove that you're a legitimate rights holder. And I think that's really, it would save a lot of court, issues. Because that's, happens all the time. People taking others for copyright file, using their content, photos, blog posts, whatever. So, just wanted to.
And Ravencoin supports NFTs. We just call them unique assets. You can create them. They have a hashtag in the middle of them, so they're easily identifiable. And you can attach that again to IPFS data. So if you wanted to attach it to, for example, the copyrighted article or to a picture of some unique item so that it's kind of a proof of authenticity, that type of thing. So we already have some projects using them that way on chain now.
Oh, go for it.
Those NFTs, they're tradable, right?
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Yep. Yeah, they're just guaranteed unique. The only difference really is that you get a kind of a larger character set to kind of guarantee the uniqueness of the name. And then also the chain guarantees that there's only one of them.
Yeah, and on that note, I kind of wanted to ask you, Tron, as well. Speaking on interoperability, are there any plans, and maybe you guys already do this, on having unique assets interoperable with ERC-721s or NFTs, pretty much having a token on the Ethereum blockchain representing a token on the you know, the Ravencoin blockchain.
Yeah, I would love that. I think our first step is actually to get Raven itself interoperable with just like either through Ren Raven, something like that. So that there's a kind of a non-custodial way to exchange and put the Raven value on the Ethereum blockchain is kind of one of our kind of early projects this year.
Beautiful. And I mean, I guess, you know, obviously Komodo, same question, of course. I mean, I think you guys already do something similar, but you know, is there any plans on that as well, having come out of Komodo NFTs linked to somewhere on the Ethereum blockchain, or?
Currently, that's not so much a focus for us. I mean, we have discussed like a wrapped Komodo version, but I don't think it's not really a high priority type of thing at the moment. We're really focusing on atomic swap technology, and our main focus is getting as many different kinds of coin tokens integrated. The way I see it is, let's let projects like Ravencoin and Verus focus on what they do best, and that's the token side of things, and we figure out how to get them interoperable with everyone else.
Yeah.
Beautiful. And Charles, I mean, any thoughts on that too? Obviously, I know since you're part of the team as well. Any, in the whole NFT stuff, all that?
Yeah, I think I covered it. Oh, wait, there's two Charles.
No, you're good. Yeah,
you. No, you are the one. But TTYX, I think maybe what also is the curiosity is about the interoperability of So Komodo is a lot about scalability, security, and interoperability, and interoperability is huge. So what do you see as going on? You're coming at it from a different angle as well. What can you say about how Komodo reaches out? And also, if you want to say how people can reach out to Komodo, that would be helpful.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, to answer the question of how to reach out to us, I think the easiest way would be to write us directly or just visit one of our websites. We have partner email set up, so partners@komodoplatform.com. If you send us an email there, you'll get an answer probably sooner because there's a few eyes on that email. And that's usually the first step. Once you reach out to us and you let us know what you want to do, we set up a meeting with you and just try to see, how we can collaborate. We try to work with every project. We know that every single blockchain is different. Everyone has different needs. So we're very flexible in that we allocate resources to, make sure things are integrated properly. In regards to the NFTs, I think Jason covered it. It's not something we're fully focused on. I do think the interesting side of it would be, now that you mentioned, for example, like being able to tokenize a blog post or an image or something like this through the NFTs, that would become swappable through the Atomic DEX. I think that's something interesting that we should look at. I think it opens a lot of doors for different types of trading that we haven't really thought of that aren't necessarily linked to financial value. It could be intellectual property value. It could be all sorts of things that people could be swapping back and forth. And if Ravencoin is already supported on the Atomic DEX protocol, then their NFTs should be supported. If they're not now, they should be in the near future. That's just my thoughts on it.
Nice.
Beautiful. No, yeah. And I mean, on that note, we're going to be kicking it off to, JC for some of the stats and whatnot in a little bit. But before we finish off, Tron, you have anything else kind of just in regards to Ravencoin and anything new you guys have coming up in 2021?
2021, we're kind of focusing on moving to a foundation model and working on funding that and getting, development. More development. I would like going back just a little bit in the conversation. I would love to have assets, restricted assets, the NFTs all be tradable on Atomic DEX. That would be incredible. Right now, Raven's on there, supported, works great. Getting the assets on there would be amazing. I think there would be a huge demand for that.
Interoperability for the win.
We should keep talking about it internally. You know, you guys can dedicate resources to it. We can dedicate resources to it to make sure that it gets on the Atomic DEX.
Great. I agree, because this is the beginnings of a cross-chain stock exchange. Having these restricted assets, being able to be swaps for even other restricted assets possible, but any coin in crypto. I think it could be the beginning of something great.
Agreed. Start of something new. Beautiful. And any last words from, I'll kind of kick it off to you, Alex. If you have anything last you want to say before we kind of end things off, and I'll kick it to Oink as well. That's Oink wants to go first. I know. Yeah. There you go. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, basically, I want to can you hear me now?
Yeah, we hear you loud and clear.
We're good. We're good.
Cool. Yeah, I wanted to come back a bit to the privacy topic, because I think that is really important to outline what we want to do next year. I forgot to tell that we also want to implement anonymous staking and anonymous voting, because NavCoin is a community-based project. We didn't run any ICO or didn't have any pre-mine. So we are completely managed from inside and funded from inside. And users from our community are able to create proposals to fund their own projects. And this happens with DAO voting in the network. And we also want to introduce anonymous voting in the governance layer, which I think is also a new thing that really excites me for the future of NavCoin.
Exciting, then. Very good. It's always nice to hear new things and what you're excited about. Cool.
And then, Oink, anything last on your end with Verus?
Mainly interoperability is not just flows of money, but it's more like flows of information. Money is a kind of information. And I see here different projects talked about getting tokens or NFTs or anything flown from one chain to the other. But I think we live in an information society. I think it is very important to focus on the flow of information, and that can range from change of supply to educational information or academic information going from one party to another and being shared to everyone. In that respect, it is important to mention that Verus is developing an open standard, the Verus data exchange format, which is hashed down to a 20 character hash and then can be exchanged across every blockchain that connects to Verus.
Oh yeah.
Beautiful. No, we're looking forward to all of these things, eh?
Oh yeah, no, interoperability is definitely going to be the future. I think that's one thing we can all agree on.
I also want to agree on, tell us what's going on here, Hunter. We want some stats.
RJ Charming, what do you got for us? What are we at? How many swaps we got? Let's see.
It looks like right at the end of the swap hour, we were right over 10,000 at 11,000. So that means that everybody here that was at event 5 definitely
went up again. It just went up.
Went up again.
Right now.
Oh,
no way.
I was going to say it. Then I just pulled it and I saw 15,000. There we go. And we got 15,000 here at the end of the half an hour after the atomic swap hour. This is killer. 291 users.
What's the total?
I don't know. I haven't checked since I got back for the event. I know that After the kind of after, there was an after hour privacy talk that the, a bunch of the devs stayed and we ended up streaming for all the privacy event, and it was really cool. And I remember at the end of that, I saw a plug in Keybase that we were at like 104,000 on the database. So I guess, somewhere between 100 and 200,000 right now is my guess.
Wow, that's pretty good.
Come on, Komodo, you guys sound happy about that.
I think you guys away a bit.
Crazy.
Kadan, yesterday you mentioned, or I don't remember who it was, but like the failed swap ratio is very low too. It's like
minimal. It was like it was like really minimal, and we just like have to, you know, keep in mind this is like a really 100% like peer to peer trade. Like this is like a 1-to-1 connection literally, and if you run this on your phone or something, you know, so this part is that like cancel a swap, just turn the phone down, lose internet connection, whatever. This will just like time out, and that will already be basically called a failed swap. But what's a failed swap? What does this mean, right? Okay, you as a user, you don't lose anything, right? Just like to put like the most important thing there, right? So this is all like, you know, crypto validated. This is all built on cryptographic and blockchain based means. It's trustless, decentralized. The protocol is refueled, it's safe, secure. So even if you're already within the atomic swap process and there were the initial transactions that took place and moved your funds away from your key, you would still be able to basically redeem that back, you know, unless you received like the transaction from the other party, right? And unless like you can basically like release it with a hash lock. So this is like really super safe, secured, and this was all implemented like into the application. So you'll have a bond. Even if your funds were locked basically for the swap, so no one can scam the other, you just like click the funds and they're unlocked. And you are the only party that is able to do this, right? You have the private key, you have the power. And this is like all about this technology. And so these little fails that you've seen are likely cases of aborted canceled swaps, etc.
Yeah.
No, but that brings it nicely around to the security aspect of Komodo and Atomic Dex, and just the by nature of atomic swaps and how it's set up here is that it's safe for you. Like a failed swap is basically you just didn't get the swap, but you still keep everything and no worries on that end.
Still got your Morty, still got your Ricks. That's it.
Okay, so we're gonna need to end here, but we want to thank everyone who joined us, and we're going to have another event, the final event for just this weekend, which is just the beginning, but it's a very huge turnout so far. All the swapping, all you swappers have really juiced it up big time. It's pretty crazy, actually, and I'm super floored here. So we have event 6, we're gonna be talking about a lot about the future, 2021. I know Hunter is excited about that. Yeah. And so we'd love to see you around at that time. Come back and keep swapping. Come join us on the live stream. And thanks to Jay Charming. Thanks to Otto behind the scenes, of course. And thanks to Hunter for being here. We'd also like to thank Verus Oink. Thanks for being here. Thanks to Alex from NavCoin. Thanks to Ravencoin came here, Tron representing. Thank you so much. You guys had such an amazing discussion with Komodo's Polycrypto blog and PTYX. So thank you so much, everyone. And Kadan,
thank you for having
knowledge, so much wisdom.
We appreciate you, really. Thank you so much.
Is there what's the best place that, you know, anyone can find you guys, you know, whether it be your platforms itself or, you know, the respective coins platform?
Ravencoin.org.
Okay.
For Verus, best way to contact us is through verus.io. And basically our Discord community is the most active one. There's always someone around to answer a question or ping the one that can.
And, no, I think Alex is still muted. Unless he went around. PTYX, you can go. You can go, Charles. Go ahead. You can go.
Sure. Yeah, no, I mean, for Komodo, you know, you can visit our website, komodoplatform.com. If you want to get in touch with us in regards to partnerships, partners@komodoplatform.com, and we'll get back to you as soon as possible. We're looking forward to hearing from projects. You know, we want to hear your ideas on how you can use the Atomic Dex protocol. If you think it'll be useful to you, we can work towards integrating. So yeah, reach out to us.
Thanks. And okay, we will try our best to throw everything, all the details down in the YouTube or other areas that we, I think we already posted on Twitter. And we're just gonna head over. Thanks, Hunter, so much. I really enjoyed this time with you, and I hope to be back with you again. Yeah, and before we go out completely, we've got to definitely hear from Jay Charming one last time. You know, we didn't even talk about prizes much. There's just so much going on here. This weekend is so crazy. Jay Charming, please save me.
Yeah, I've actually got the I've got the event up on my screen, the final event for this weekend, event 6, Komodo 2021 and beyond. That's being dubbed the Dragon's Tale, the end of the event. We took the bookends of this event and then plugged all the community spotlights and projects that came and talked and everything else. So if you've been swapping, if you're not swapping, if you want to swap, if you have downloaded the Atomic Dex, or if you haven't, any of it, just come on by to this event 6. Starts at 6:30 p.m. UTC. Everybody earns prizes. And speaking of that, the Firo prize drop is going to be happening in the next hours leading up to event 6. We're still getting that spun out to everybody's wallets, and you'll still earn some RAIN prizes from Raven, from Nav, and from Verus here. Those are going to be getting rained in at the beginning of event 6, so be sure to come on by. And then the swaps that you make during event 6 also get you RAIN by the end of the event there, because you guys, that's going to be some of our local KMD RAIN. And we've got some leftover prizes from all of the different projects that participated in. So if you missed an event, if you wanted to get some EMC2, if you wanted to get some QDOM, if you wanted to get something like that, come to event 6 and you can pick up those rewards there. This event is going to be just a little bit of everybody and everything. And we're going to have a lot of talking points and a lot of things to come. And we've got a lot of we've just got a lot of really exciting stuff for 2021 and moving out of the stress test, including some recaps over what all happened on the stress test and maybe some of those numbers, like how many swaps have been made up until that point.
Nice. Wow. Five out of six done. And we got one more to go just on this weekend. Thank you to Komodo team. The Komodo team is doing such a great job for all of us. And we're all participating, making this happen. So we'll see you soon. Take us out, Otto. Bye, everyone.
Peace.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Ciao, ciao, ciao.